Today's gospel lesson is found in the book of Matthew, chapter 21, verses 1 through 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to your daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heavens!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee."
Choosing things.
Sometimes I have some trouble choosing things. And think about all the choices that you make in a day. All of them. Just think of all the choices that you make. Most of them, you probably don't even give subconscious, you probably don't give conscious thought to, right? There are some choices like breathing that you just do on your own, right? Everybody do me a favor, take a deep breath and out. Now, that's not the first breath that you've taken today. Hopefully it's not the last. And you just do breathing on your own without thinking about it too much. And there are some choices that we make that we don't think about too much. Others we put a lot of effort and research into. For instance, some people don't think too much about what clothes to put on, right? Some people just blindly pick out what they're going to wear. They throw something on, as long as it's in the clean or the dirty pile, right? You just grab something, put it on, and out the door you go. Just in case you're wondering, this particular outfit took a lot more intentionality than other days, but that's okay. Some of you probably didn't even choose what you were going to wear. Your spouse did. Am I right on some of that? Yeah, a little bit. So there are some choices that are important. There are other choices that aren't. For some people, choosing what you wear is incredibly important. For instance, for me this morning, it was incredibly important that I look disorganized, right? That it appeared that I blindly picked out what I was going to wear because it fit into the message. Other people probably didn't care too much what they were going to wear as long as they just threw it on and it fit. So today we're going to talk about choices a little bit. The title of the message today is Choosing a King, because it is Palm Sunday, so we'll tie that in a little bit. But I want you to focus on this question first, okay? This question, what's important to you? What's important to you when it comes to your choices? Because whatever's important is the choice that you will spend the most time on. And we'll talk about that in just a little bit. Today we're going to be in 1 Samuel 16. Everybody say 1 Samuel.
1 Samuel.
Now, we're not going to be in 1 Samuel next week. We weren't in 1 Samuel last week, so this is just a one-off sermon. 1 Samuel 16, that's in the Old Testament. I know we've been in the New Testament for a while. We were in the book of Acts. We talked about the development and the growth of the early church and how the leaders, how their examples apply to us and all of that. Today is about choosing a king and making important choices and how we decide what is an important choice. And in 1 Samuel 16, we're going to run into some characters who had to make an important choice. 1 Samuel 16. If you're there, say, I'm there. If you're not there, say, hold on. Hold on. Okay. All right. That gives me a chance to get a drink. 1 Samuel chapter 16, starting with verse 1. This is probably a familiar passage for some of you. The Lord said to Samuel, how long will you mourn for Saul, since I've rejected him as king over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and be on your way. I'm sending you to Jesse of Bethlehem. I've chosen one of his sons to be the king. So, for those who don't know, okay, the king at the time in 1 Samuel 16, Old Testament, is King Saul. Everybody say Saul. Now, this is not the same guy. I repeat, this is not the same guy that we spent all this time talking about in Acts. Right? It's not the Saul who would later become Paul. They were born thousands of years apart. Okay? So this is a totally different guy, King Saul, that is mentioned here in 1 Samuel 16. And King Saul hasn't quite turned out to be the king that everybody had hoped. The people wanted a king, if you remember. God said, no, let me rule. And the people said, oh, but we want a king. Everybody else has a king. Let's get a king. We want a king. God said, okay, I'll give you a king. It's what you want. So he chooses Saul, who the scriptures tell us stands a head taller than everybody else, who the scriptures tell us was probably one of the greatest hunters and warriors in the entire nation, if not the entire world. Like, if you think about a king in your mind, Saul would be the guy that you picture. But unfortunately for the people of Israel, Saul turned out to be greedy and selfish and cowardly. Just not a good guy. And so God speaks to Samuel, who is a prophet. Prophets at that point were chosen to anoint kings and give their blessing from God to these kings for the next one in line. And so God tells Samuel, the prophet, he says, look, we're not going to spend any time crying over spilled milk here. We're not going to cry anymore about Saul and the leader that he wasn't. We're going to move on. Go to Bethlehem. Go to Jesse. I'm going to choose one of his sons to be king. Everybody still with me? All right. Here we go. Verse 2, but Samuel said, how can I go? Saul will hear about it and kill me. The Lord said, take a heifer with you and say, I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what to do. You are to anoint for me the one that I indicate. Samuel did what the Lord said. When he arrived at Bethlehem, the elders of the town trembled when they met him. They asked, do you come in peace? Samuel replied, yes, in peace. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Consecrate yourselves and come to the sacrifice with me. Then he consecrated Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. So, Samuel's a little unsure. If I choose the next king, then King Saul's going to be mad. He's got this bad temper. He's not a wise, godly leader. He's got some issues. He's going to kill me if he finds out that I'm anointing another king. And God says, look, take a cow, go to the temple, sacrifice it to me. God's reminding Samuel who's in charge. He's reminding him who Samuel serves. It's not Saul. It's God. So God is essentially saying to Samuel, don't worry, I've got this. So he goes to the temple, and the prophet shows up in town. Now, here's the thing. We don't have any prophets nowadays. And so you might not be familiar with what this meant when a prophet showed up in town. If you read through the Old Testament at all, if you spend any time in the Hebrew scriptures, you'll see that prophets weren't always the most welcomed people in the world. Usually, they were coming to bear bad news. Usually, a prophet would come into town and say, well, boys, you messed up. Now there's going to be fire from heaven. There's going to be plagues, a famine. There's going to be an earthquake that shakes everything down to its boots. There's going to be drama. And so the people were trembling when they see Samuel show up. And rightfully so, because in their world at that time, when a prophet shows up delivering a message from God, it wasn't always a positive one. But in this case, Samuel shows up into town. They are trembling with fear. They say, do you come in peace? Like, do we need to make sure our insurance is in line? Do we need to call our family members and tell them we love them? What, like, what should we expect? Samuel says, don't worry. I come in peace. I just came to, I'm going to church. You should all come with me. Okay. So Jesse's there with some of his boys, and they're all consecrated, you know, cleaned up so that they can go to church. Continuing on. Verse 6. When they arrived, Samuel saw Eliab and thought, surely the Lord's anointed stands here before the Lord. But the Lord said to Samuel, do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at the things that man looks at. Man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. So Samuel is standing there, and he knows it's one of Jesse's boys that's going to be chosen. Now, as far as we can tell, he hasn't actually told Jesse any of this. He just says, come with me to the temple. We're going to go sacrifice a cow, have some barbecue. It's going to be a great day. And so Jesse brings his boys, and they show up at the temple, and Eliab, the oldest, he passes in front of Samuel. And I can just picture, right, Eliab, he's walking past, chiseled physique. Semi-chiseled physique. I imagine he's got this manly beard, right? Like a Brent Lawrence beard, not a beard that I grow. Like this manly beard, you know, and he's got his chest puffed out. He's walking past because he is a stud, right? Well, Samuel takes one look at Eliab and he says, oh man, that's gotta be the guy. Like he is a specimen. He is man. He is kingly material. Surely God's anointed standing right there. And God whispers, nope. He says, don't look at his height. Don't judge his appearance. He says, look, man looks at the outward appearance. Man looks at superficial things. Man looks at things that really in the long run don't matter. But God, what does it say? Looks at the heart. God had different specifications, different qualifications for who his king was going to be. My wife and I recently bought a car. How many people have ever bought a car? So you know what a joy it is. My wife and I bought a car. And whenever you buy a car, you have certain boxes that you like to check. Right? Everybody has certain needs that they want met whenever they're purchasing a new vehicle. Am I right? Now for us, we had several big ones, a couple little ones, you know, it'd be nice if we met those. So some of the big ones we had were, it had to be within budget, right? Because I'm a Dave Ramsey guy, I love financial peace and pretty much anything that Dave has done. I'm an advocate for saving up, paying all at once in cash for stuff. And so that's what we wanted to do. So there wasn't any wiggle room as far as let's just make payments or let's just get a bigger or a newer or whatever. We had kind of a set amount that we were going to pay. We also, I don't know if you know this, we would take trips across country 3 times a year, roughly. And so space would be a little nice. Because if you've ever been crowded in a car for 12 hours with a toddler and toys and spilled sippy cups and it's just uncomfortable. And so some space would be nice. Cargo space, interiors, but having some space would be nice. It was also important for us to have low mileage. There's no reason for us to go, okay, here's Rachel's car. Let's get one that is twice the mileage that'll blow up as soon as we pull into the driveway. But instead, we wanted something that had lower mileage, and we wanted something that got better fuel economy. Because again, we travel cross country, a lot of miles on that day, so it's got to be good on gas. So we found our car, we picked it out, we did some negotiating, and I got to tell you, that in all honesty here, I had to wrestle with this decision of God. It required some prayer on my part. Because I didn't want it to be done out of competition. Oh, they got a new car, now I want a new car. Like, I didn't want that to be my motive, and so I had to do some soul searching. I didn't want it to just be hey, look how good we're doing. We got a car. How do you like that? Yeah, I didn't want it to be like that. Like, I wanted it to meet legitimate, like, I wanted it to be a gift. I wanted it to be legitimate. And so I'm wrestling with God. God, if this is about competition for me, then I pray you would help me with that. If this is about making myself stand up and look important, God, help me with that. And so I wrestled with God on this decision. It wasn't just something that was made split second. And there's also the whole thing of when you're a pastor, yeah, and you buy a car, you always wrestle with how godly a car are you supposed to get? Because we got a 2014 Nissan Rogue, okay? Now, that's all fine and dandy. If I had stood up here and said, we just got a Lamborghini Diablo, I hope it's okay. That puts your heart in a totally different position, doesn't it? And you're going, I'm going to have to cut back how much I'm giving to the church. Pastor's obviously skimming a little off the top. I mean, how come he gets a Lamborghini and I'm, right? And so you wrestle with this, okay, this is what I want. This is what people will allow me to have. So there's a lot of prayer that goes into that. Now, of course, I had to consult my wife as well. Because any major decision, be it financial or not, that you don't consult with your spouse is just an opportunity for division. Everybody say amen. Right? Plus, we were trading her car in, so I thought it might be a good idea to take her in. And so I told her, Rach, if when we get there and you're not happy, just tell me and we can walk away. That's the wonderful part about buying a car when there's not an emergency, is you can turn around and walk away. But we got there, we were happy, the boxes were checked, and we have a new car. So here's my question that I want you to think about. How much do you pray about major decisions? Here Samuel is choosing not a volunteer. He's not choosing somebody to mow his lawn. He's not choosing somebody to get the mail. He is choosing the next king of Israel. The one whose name would be written in the history books. The one who would dictate the nation. The one who would lead the people in and out of war. It's a big deal. And so Samuel prays before the decision. In the middle of the decision, he thinks, God, is that the one? And God says, no. He's in constant communication with God during this whole process. The second question is, who do you consult? Who do you talk to make a decision? Does it create opportunities for growth or opportunities for division? Because I found that I'm dumb enough that if I make decisions on my own, it's probably the wrong one. 9 times out of 10. Everybody still with me? Okay. Amen. Let's continue on. Verse 8. So God has just told Samuel, the Lord looks at the heart. Verse 8. Then Jesse called Abinadab and had him pass in front of Samuel. But Samuel said, the Lord has not chosen this one either. Jesse then had Shema pass by, but Samuel said, nor has the Lord chosen this one. Jesse had 7 of his sons pass before Samuel, but Samuel said to him, the Lord has not chosen these. So he asked Jesse, are these all the sons you have? Now, I don't know if you noticed this stuff. Again, as I mentioned, as far as we can tell in the text, Samuel hasn't actually told Jesse why he's there. And he hasn't told him he's there to pick a king from among one of his boys. But Jesse somehow is able to read the situation. A prophet has showed up into town for some reason. Surely it's not just to go to church in the little town of Bethlehem. And so he sees Samuel looking Eliab up and down. Eliab striking back and forth like a rooster, right? Manly man that he is. He sees Samuel kind of wrestling with this decision, and Samuel kind of shakes his head no and stuff. And so then if you read in verse 8, it says, then Jesse had Abinadab pass in front of Samuel. Like, oh, okay, go ahead. Abinadab, he's the secondborn, so not, you know, not as cool as firstborn, but because I'm a firstborn. So he puffs out his chest and he tries to walk casually in front of Samuel. And he's like, oh, let me lift this cart here. Ugh, got my pen, thank you. Ugh, all right, there we go, I am. Oh, pretty tired. And Samuel says, nope, not him either. So then Jesse is caught on to this whole process, and he's like, okay, Shema, you go on, Shema. Shema, who, by the way, is named after the Jewish word for peace. Okay, all right. He's named back, like the great Shema. You know, that's great stuff. Okay, Shema, you go. Shema's like, hey, man. I'll be your king. Sam's like, no, no. So then starts the parade. Like, all seven of these boys that are with Jesse pass in front of Samuel, and they all have different qualities and different traits, and they have different things. Maybe one is stronger than the rest, and one is funnier than the rest, and one is taller than the rest, and one is faster than the rest, and one is more cunning than the rest, and one is a better hunter, a better leader, a better talker, and they all have these different qualifications. And they all pass in front of Samuel, and God keeps on saying, nope, mm-mm. Nope, nope, mm-mm. Nope. And finally, Samuel, he gets to the end of the line, and he says, are there any more? Like, is that it? Are there any more? Because God sent me here for a purpose. Are there any more? So let's talk about the election. I figured there'd be some grumbling. Yeah, so the Illinois primaries were this last week where you got to do a little voting. And it's funny, it's been such a crazy year, right? Such a crazy time when it comes to the candidates and elections and all that stuff. And one of the interesting comments that I've kept hearing was very similar to what we found in 1 Samuel 16. The debates wrap up. The voting's done, you look at the ballot, and I've heard a lot of people say, are there any more? Like, is there anybody else? Is there somebody else that we can choose? And we spend so much time talking about this stuff, right? Just think about it in your own lives. Those of you who are online, how many times in the last week have you seen anything about Donald Trump, Hillary Clinton, or Bernie Sanders? In the last 6 months, how much have you seen on TV, in the news, in the newspapers, online? Anybody know how many debates we've had so far this year? Yeah, you lose count, right? We were supposed to have one here tomorrow, but they canceled it. Praise God. We spend so much time, and rightfully so, right? We are choosing the president of the United States of America. An important decision, to be sure. And so you want to be researched. You want to be well-informed. You want to spend time and wrestle with this decision and consult. And the candidates, they put forth a lot of effort too, right? They do their strutting back and forth, trying to outdo each other, make each other look smaller, and they want to look bigger. And so they spend millions, no joke, millions of dollars to be the next president. Countless commercials. People put signs out in their yard. Slap bumper stickers that are going to be outdated in 2 years on the backs of their cars. And we spend so much time in conversation, commercials, on all this stuff. Which is fine. If you've done that, that's fine. Because it's important to you. But I just wonder how much time did you spend choosing a king? Like, did you spend that much time choosing Jesus? Have you thought about your faith at all in the last 6 months? Because we've sure spent a lot of time thinking about the election, about somebody who's going to govern our country in a complicated system for 4 years. And so I just wonder if we spent any time at all about the King who will lead our lives into eternity. Just a question. You know, I told this to my small group, the small group that meets on Wednesdays. We've had this conversation a couple times. I grew up in the church. How many people grew up in the church? I think most of us. I grew up in the church, and so I was basically born on the pew. I mean, that's pretty much how it worked. My first cry was, you know, Father Abraham and his sons. Like, I was kids choir, Sunday school, you know, all that. And once I got to college, you know, when I decided, okay, I'm going to be a preacher, youth minister, whatever I happen to be, you know, when you start working with all this stuff, my eyes were open to all the options. Like, I had no idea so many isms existed in our world. And so I open my eyes and there's all these different thoughts and schools of thought and ideologies and philosophies about how life happened and who we should follow and what our hearts should be guided by. And so I'm digging through all of this stuff, and it's hard and it's uncomfortable and it's unpleasant. And one of the things that I personally have to question, have to ask myself again and again, just to keep myself honest about my faith, is, am I a Christian because I've actually chosen it? Or am I just a Christian because it's convenient? Like, if I were born in India, and mom was a Buddhist and dad was a Hindu, would I still choose Jesus? How much time did we spend choosing a king? 1 Samuel 16. Saul asked Jesse, "Are these all the sons that you have?" And Jesse answered, "Well, there's still the youngest. There's still David. He's tending the sheep." Samuel said, "Send for him. We will not sit down until he arrives." Uncomfortable. So he sent, had it brought in. He was ruddy, with a fine appearance and handsome features. Then the Lord said, "Rise and anoint him. He is the one." So Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came upon David in power. He's the one. Samuel asked Jesse, "Do you have any more sons?" And it never occurred to Jesse to go get David. Like, all the other boys are here. 7 out of 8, that's not bad.
Anybody with a big family go to the grocery store, you're like, 1, 2, 3, 4. That's close enough.
Right? No, you make sure you got all the kids for the important event. The prophet has come to town. David's out in the field playing a harp somewhere. He probably won't get paid. David's covered in sheep doo-doo. He probably won't get picked. David's the youngest. He probably won't get picked. Samuel said, well, go get David and bring David in. God says, that's the one. Right there. Time to stand up, anoint him, put some oil on his head, bless him in that way. He's the king. I said, behold, the Spirit of the Lord. Get this. Holy Spirit moved before Acts 2, by the way. The Spirit of God came upon David in power from that day forward. And the rest of David's legacy you are well familiar with. David, slayer of giants. David, writer of Psalms. David, simple yet forgiven man. And then you fast forward a couple thousand years later. The prophet has come to town. The king riding on a donkey. And what do the people say? Hosanna. Hosanna to the son of David. See, our choices can have an impact years down the line. Generations down the line. If Samuel had ignored what God had said and just chosen Eliab, he's a good-looking guy, he must be the king. How different would it have ended up? Would Eliab have been a man after God's own heart? I don't know. See, sometimes we make quick choices. And quick choices are like clothes. Easy to put on, easy to take off. But not every choice should be a quick one. Because our choices can have an impact for generations to come. Last point. Choosing the king of your life is the most important decision you will ever make. Let me say it again. Choosing a king of your life, not a president, okay? Not a CEO, not even your spouse, as important as that decision is. Choosing the king of your life, the one whom you have dedicated your all to, the one who will be the lens, the filter through which all your decisions are made, be they political or otherwise. Choosing the king of your life, the one who will fight for you, the one who will defend you, the one who will give you value, the one who will give you identity, the one who has saved you. Choosing the king of your life is the most important decision you will ever make. So please, don't make that choice lightly. Wrestle with it. Dig through it. Some of us have been Christians for so long we forgot why. And so what we need to do is we need to go home and go, okay, blank slate. If I'm not a believer, why would I choose Jesus? Why? Why Jesus? This Middle Eastern guy that lived 2,000 years ago, why does he matter? Some of us need to go home and think about that. Some of us say, well, I just live by faith. Okay. That's fine. You probably drive without a seatbelt, too. Good luck with that. Wrestle with it. Choosing the king. I know it's overkill, but it's important. Right? And the important decisions are the ones we spend the most effort, the most time, the most money, the most energy investing in. Choosing the king of your life is the most important decision you will ever make. So spend a little time with it. Don't make it lightly. And together, we can make Christianity great again. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this opportunity on Palm Sunday to sing praise to the King, but not only that, Lord, to think about why we worship, why we praise, why we commit to this King, Jesus. We know that your Son doesn't want followers who are half-hearted, that just make an emotional decision, that just make a flippant choice. But God, you want dedicated, devoted followers who have wrestled with the options, who have looked at it all and said, when I look at everything that this world has to offer, I see that it dims in comparison to the glory of Jesus Christ. And so I commit my life to him forever and ever, and nothing else compares. Father, be with us as we wrestle with these things. Because for some of us, it's the first time we will have ever done so. We thank you for your grace and for your Son. It's in King Jesus' mighty name that we pray. Amen.